old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. And it's good enough for me. So give me that old-time.
All right, Willie Nelson. Bringing us into the old-time religion of Moses here. We had Go Down Moses, and then we had old-time religion going at the same time here. Or not at the same time.
Do you know the next verse?
No.
Can I put the next verse real quick?
Yeah, go for it.
Just
go
real,
for it.
Real quick.
It was good for our mother.
Oh, I thought the next one was going to be
it was good for our fathers.
No good enough for Moses.
Oh, good.
That's one of them.
There is a line in there where he says that.
Right?
It's good enough for Moses. It's good enough for me. Actually, good enough for Moses doesn't quite sound like the right thing to say compared to what Nyssa has to say. Enough is not right. In fact, there's this great footnote back here. Well, we'll just start with the footnote. Why not? There's a lot of great Greek back here, by the way, Jager. If you haven't been looking at your endnotes.
I've been every now and then taking a...
I have to look at my endnotes because I haven't been looking at my Greek.
Yeah,
which is a big problem. But today is my turnaround day for Greek. But on footnote 198, I found this to be interesting. It's right after he talks about... I mean, this is kind of getting all the way to the end of the text already. The really, really good stuff at the end. His comment on page 95, Gregory's comment, where he says, and this is just, I mean, I've never thought of this passage of Scripture this way, but I think it's just fascinating. John the Sublime, of course, that's John the Evangelist, penetrated into the luminous darkness, says, no one has ever seen God. Thus asserting that knowledge of the divine essence is unattainable not only by men, but also by every intelligent creature. So the commentary at one point says, Chrysostom specifically states angels as not knowing God's nature, which is obvious. I mean, it's got to be true, right? Depending on what you mean by knowing, of course. But this passage, no one has ever seen God. Normally you think of it as because only those who have died can see God. But the way that Gregory takes it is no. It's comprehensive. No one, no creature has ever, either after death or before death, seen God in the sense of seeing that we normally think of seeing. But anyway, this it's that phrase luminous darkness, which is paradoxical. What our commentators, I gotta give them credit. I keep forgetting their names. Eberle, Malherbe and Ferguson. They refer to it as the use of oxymoron. They actually point out a bunch of other places that he does it. So if you look at page 178 at the top, which is endnote 198, he talks about how Gregory delights in these paradoxes. Sober inebriation, watchful sleep, passionless love, wise folly, stationary movement, and maybe best of all, living death. And then he gives all the different places where that is, and a lot of those is actually in the commentary on the Song of Songs. So I think we're gonna see some of this stuff happening later.
I have to make this comment.
Yeah.
In the Phaedo, Plato,
of course you did.
talks about the philosophers. In some sense, they shouldn't be afraid to die because they're already like living out their death. They're like walking dead, I think is the phrase he uses.
And his point is being that they're dead to sort of like the pleasures of the world.
Yeah. So the people that look at them, they see no recognizable worldly life in them.
And this is why this great comment by Gregory. This goes back to an earlier one. I don't think we brought it out, and I'm probably not going to find it. But it was so fascinating to me about the virtuous man, and how the virtuous man is seen as like worthless to the world. Do you remember this?
Say that one more time.
Here it is. Page 57. Paragraph 9, right at the top there. It's where he starts talking about education. This is when we were talking about free will. Or we were talking about the midwife.
Oh, right.
And pagan learning. But he says, experience teaches us that the restless and heaving motion of life thrusts from itself those who do not totally submerge themselves in the deceits of human affairs. And it reckons as a useless burden those whose virtue is annoying. That's fascinating, right? And that makes me actually think of the gadfly passage of Socrates, right? His virtue is annoying. So in some sense, maybe it's not... They're a useless burden, but maybe more important is that they're a burden, and that's the so when the one who philosophizes is walking around in this world and is living the virtuous life, they are, first of all, they're seen as what a waste of time,
right?
But they're also seen as annoying because their very being is a judgment on the world.
Yeah.
So I think that this is, I think that, where did I get into that? I don't remember. Oh, because.
That's good, though.
It is good. But I think it's important that, we recognize that, and this is something that's always in the background of my own spiritual thinking, right? And he brings this out again at one point where he talks about, and let's just go there, actually. So he talks about the difficulty of the virtuous life. And that this is on page 86, actually. So it's the passage in Moses where Moses finds the water, but the water is very bitter. And then he's told to throw the wood into the water. And then the wood somehow sweetens the water so that the people can drink it. But paragraph 132 is something that really sort of struck me because I think about this constantly. And I think it's probably a sign of my own lack of advancing in this in the life, the climb towards God, the climb up the mountain. But let me read a little bit of this, paragraph 132, page 86. The history agrees with what now happens. For to the one who has left behind the Egyptian pleasures which he served before crossing the sea, life removed from these pleasures seems at first difficult and disagreeable. But if the wood be thrown into the water, that is, if one receives the mystery of the resurrection, here we're talking about Christ, right, which had its beginning with the wood, you of course understand the cross when you hear wood, then the virtuous life, being sweetened by the hope of things to come, becomes sweeter and more pleasant than all sweetness that tickles the senses with pleasure. Mm. I mean, that is, I feel like lots of times when we read passages like that, which we find all over the place in ascetical theology, all over the place in the fathers, we think that this is just nice, pious talk, but nobody really means it, right? Mm. Everybody knows that living the virtuous life just, as my roommate in college referred to it as, we all live under the curse of Christianity. And he would watch the debauchers and the leches all around on campus and thinking to himself, I can't do things like that because of the curse of Christianity. Because he, and I agreed with him at the time, thought that the sweet life was the pleasurable one. Was the passionate one. Passionate in the sense that Gregory uses it.
Right.
But Gregory here is saying, no, it's only disagreeable and difficult at first, right? And this totally agrees with people like Teresa of Avila who said things like, you know, I thought that the life of Christianity and embracing the cross was going to be horrific. But only the first cross was really bad. Everything else was joy. I think the fact that I have to read this over again and say to myself, do I really think this is true, is what Gregory is trying to challenge the pleasure seekers, right? Mm-hmm. And I have to ask myself, how much am I still a pleasure seeker? And therefore I'm blind to this, right?
Yeah. And mean, it's interesting. The he's not saying deny the pleasures. I mean, this is I haven't given this that much thought until right now. He's not saying deny the pleasures, period. Because what he says is there's actually a sweeter, more pleasant
right.
object of pursuit.
Yeah.
Right. And that is not to be denied as pleasurable, but actually to be pursued in its pleasantness.
Right.
And I think
what... Yeah, because it's sweeter and more pleasant than that which tickles the senses.
Right, right. So this is a very strange, in some ways strange thing to say in light of his aesthetical remarks throughout most of the things we've read this semester. It seems that he is not simply saying throw out the I don't want to say the bodily life, because I think what he's trying to like transcend to a higher type of pleasure, which
uh-huh.
is only analogous to the pleasures of the body. But I think we, at least a lot of us, have done this. You recognize, oh, I can spend the next hour watching Scooby-Doo, or I can read Nyssa.
Yeah.
And you think well, some of you, we've all been in your seat. Don't worry, it's okay. We can all grow, but we've chosen the Scooby-Doo because it's just more enjoyable. But there are some of you that actually, in your heart of hearts, would say, no, I think reading Gregory of Nyssa is more enjoyable
right.
than watching Scooby-Doo right. season 54.
Right? The Return of Daphne.
Right. So the Return of Daphne as the Cookie Monster. But I think that experience is an indication, sort of a little foretaste of what's going on, that you actually, at the beginning of the life of education, you become, it becomes absurd to you. How could anyone ever want to read a book or learn Greek or X, Y, and Z, right? Fill in whatever sort of intellectual pursuit you're engaged in. And then all of a sudden, at some point, you realize, no, this is actually not just good, but pleasant.
It's not just good that I have to grip my teeth and bear through.
Yeah. Like, shoot, I wish I could just snap my fingers and all of a sudden have everything that I need to know be known. Because in some ways, the pursuit of this is the end of the activity
right.
itself, right? It's the learning of the language. Dr. Shinkavich and I and Brother Angelus and Daniel Musso are learning Greek together. And it would be a very deficient experience, and as it is right now, not being able to learn it with other people
right.
in this.
Which actually is the reason I'm behind.
Yeah.
It's because we have not been meeting.
Right. And I think that experience of the pleasantness of learning declensions would be something that is completely foreign to a lot of people. And I think something analogous to that is going on with in Nyssa, with the sacrifice of lower pleasures for higher pleasures.
Mm-hmm. But the key here is, right, you can't actually have the higher pleasures unless you sacrifice the lower pleasures.
Right.
So
and then they cease to be pleasures then, right? So it's not like, oh, what's weird is you cast them to the flames.
Yeah, you're kind of disgusted by them, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and that's, this is what this whole section is all about, right? This is sent to God, which happens by this putting behind other things. So let me make three points that all came to my mind as you were talking.
Okay.
Number one, who would choose Nyssa over Scooby-Doo? Who's the first person that came to my mind? You want to guess?
I'm thinking of that remark you made before we hit play or hit record, the two TV characters, but...
No.
Okay.
No, not that one.
Okay.
No, this guy we live with. and work with, and he's right down the hall from us. Who would be the first person to pick up Nyssa and be disgusted by Scooby-Doo? Ed Matarowski is living this life, right? Yeah. In many ways.
I mean, I think in some ways he wouldn't know that Scooby-Doo existed.
And if it was pointed out to him, he would wonder what would be the draw of anything of that nature.
Yeah, why would someone
why would someone spend time drawing Scooby-Doo cartoons?
Yeah.
Like, what's the point, right? Yeah. So I think we you know, and Gregory's big on this, right? And even in this section, gosh, it's all over. As we talk, I'm thinking of all these sections now, but I have no idea where they are in here. Yeah. Where he says specifically, you have to find a person who is doing this, right? And you have to follow that person. Mm-hmm. And so in many ways, I think Ed Matarowski is a living teacher that we should be following, right? So that's the first point. Second point, this idea of pleasures becoming sweeter with, in combination with sort of asceticism, sounds to me like also Epicurus, who you've told me about, I have not read, I've been struck by this, that you told me a long time ago, that sort of our use of the adjective Epicurean is an idea that you just plunge yourself into bodily pleasures full force, right? Mm-hmm. Bring them on. Whatever tickles my fancy, bring it on, right? But Epicurus was disgusted by people like that.
Yeah.
And he said the only way to truly enjoy a piece of pizza is to not eat a piece of pizza for like 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And yeah, maybe not eat a lot of things for like 2 weeks.
And it's somewhat ambiguous, at least I'm certainly no Epicurean scholar, but it's somewhat ambiguous in some of the stuff that I've read of his about whether or not the person living the truly pleasurable life would even want to eat the pizza out of the recognition that pizzas are a sort of good that one would take pleasure in beyond what was, say, at hand, what was there. So the idea of the near occasion of sin is present in the pizza, because then you're going to desire pizzas when all you have at hand is stale bread.
Interesting.
So if you eat a piece of pizza, what might actually happen is you might spend the rest of your time, you know,
wishing you didn't have stale bread.
Yeah. Right.
Interesting.
So at least he says the prudent person is the person who foregoes those things, at least in most situations, maybe all situations. This is what's sort of unclear, but most situations you forego even the high goods to you out of this recognition of the effects that it could have on your future, what it's going to do in regards to your perception,
your quotidian future, your everyday future.
Right. And so then you think, that one time that I ate that pizza, that was it. Now look at me.
I'm eating stale bread every day.
You're wallowing in the
in
the stale bread store.
Shoot, man, that's something really. That's something.
So then,
the
truly pleasurable person is the pleasant person. The person living the pleasant life is the person who just is willing to just embrace what nature provides. He says,
that sounds very water. Nietzschean.
Yeah. Water and stale bread. Maybe some locust every now and then.
Really? Wow. He and John the Baptist would have been buds.
So Seneca, who was a Stoic, which was the opposite philosophical camp. They were like complete opposite ends of the spectrum. The one said the highest good is pleasure. The other, the Stoic, said the highest good is virtue, is sort of the life of virtue, life of reason. And Seneca says that the Epicureans, the true Epicureans, there's too many posers out there. That's the problem. The true Epicureans.
It's always the problem.
if the posers realized and weren't hiding behind the name of Epicurus, they would realize just how, quote, pleasurable the life of Epicurus was, that they probably wouldn't be Epicureans.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, man. That's awesome.
Yeah. So, okay. So he's trying to do a ressourcement on Epicurus as a Stoic. I mean, it's really postmodern.
I got to read both of those guys, man.
It's actually a beautiful example of intellectual honesty.
Yeah. Which goes back to the Ricean comment. All is ours. All is ours. Yeah. Nothing is
even
out of
the Epicureans.
Realm. Yeah. Even for that matter,
Scooby-Doo.
I wasn't thinking Scooby-Doo. I was thinking of the guy, Eunomian. Even the Eunomian is ours, where he's right.
Yeah, right.
But last point here, third point. This gets us to another point that Nyssa brings up throughout this text so far, but we haven't really talked about it. He brings up a couple times here is the sameness, right? How you can experience the same thing as another person, right? The same object as another person, but it'd be totally different, right? And I think that this point about Epicurus and his and the stale bread is really important, right? So the guy who eats pizza and then is given stale bread the next day is unhappy,
right?
And doesn't really taste the stale bread, but instead
tastes the lack of pizza.
Yeah. Or doesn't taste the lack of pizza. only tastes the stale bread as a lack of pizza, right?
Right. Yeah.
And so he's sad, depressed, and disappointed. Whereas the Epicurean, the true Epicurean, mm-hmm. is the one who tastes the stale bread for the good that it is.
Right.
He says similar things in here, right? So, for example, on page 87, when he's talking about the rock, right? The rock that Moses hits to bring out the water, right? And you know this. You probably know the famous story where he hits it twice, right? And then he gets in trouble because he didn't trust God.
Yeah.
But that was, I mean, one of the reasons he got in trouble was because he'd already hit rocks and turned them into water. All right. This is not the only rock water situation that happened in these 40 years.
Yeah.
And so the situation that's happening that he's talking about here when he hits the rock and the water comes forth in the oasis, or maybe it's after the oasis. I think it's in the oasis. But he says, it's the same rock to everyone, right? But to those who have been refreshed, they are capable of receiving God, he says. For the rock, as the apostle says, is Christ, who is moisturless and resistant to unbelievers. Yeah. But if one should employ the rod of faith, he becomes drink to those who are thirsty and flows into those who receive him. For he says, I and my Father shall come to him and make our home with him. So there's this very interesting thing where even, you know, and maybe this kind of gets into the realm of sort of evangelization and the postmodern world that we live in. And you look around and you see all these people and they just shun Christ, has been there, done that kind of thing. Who would actually follow that? That's such a worthless way to live, right? You're missing out on life. But of course they would say that because he looks like just a rock to them, moistureless and resistant to unbelievers. But the one who has the rod of faith sees Christ as the one who satiates the thirst, right? The one who quenches the thirst. But it's the same rock, right? And this happens all over the place where it's the same thing that's being encountered, but being encountered by the virtuous one, the one who philosophizes in the virtuous life,
right.
is something different is seen than the other person, right? I think he makes the comparison with the Egyptians in the water and Israelites in the water, right?
Right. And so the principle are similar. I mean, it's along these lines on page 82, paragraph 119. This comes up again a little later. Actually, where you were referencing with the rock, paragraph 119. Then occurred the manifestation of the divine nature, which manifests itself in the way that one is capable of receiving.
Mm-hmm.
So interesting that what he's, I think two aspects of that are interesting, that God is going to have to, not have to, but if he's going to manifest himself, it will be according to the mode of the receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, there's no sense in revealing oneself if it's not according to how one can receive the revelation of it, right? And then second, that means the receiver has to be in the proper mode of reception in order to receive that revelation.
Right.
Right. So you're not going to be capable of understanding geometry if you live a life of Scooby-Doo.
Right.
The mode of reception of geometry is not via Cartoon Network.
Shaggy doesn't teach you about right triangles.
No, you're not going to get... You're not going to get how to prove the Pythagorean theorem from Shaggy. Although, Velma, maybe. Okay.
Wow, sorry. This analogy is really, really taking on a life of its own.
Sorry about that. But I think the receiver, so which just highlights this incredibly interesting reality that revelation is dialogical. It's mm-hmm. something that occurs both from the standpoint of the giver,
right,
the revealer, God, and from the receiver. Otherwise, there would be no revelation if there wasn't a reception of it. Now, that doesn't mean everyone has to receive the revelation, but that there's some active role that we play in the revelation of God being brought to its end, its perfection.
Yeah, I wonder how much we miss out on the idea of receptivity when we have this when we live in this sort of very uniform, mechanized post-industrial world where everything comes out the same, you know, from the conveyor belt.
Yeah.
And so we think of human persons in the same way.
Yeah.
And therefore we think if God reveals himself, then everybody can now know him.
Right.
But this is not how I was going to say Moses, but probably Moses, yeah, but also Gregory,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
sees this,
yeah,
which is why this whole point of like this path before you can actually go up the mountain and why Moses is the only one who can go up the mountain,
yeah,
makes sense. Right?
And so think about the perfect example of the reception of the revelation, which only occurred by the great fiat. So I mean, Mary is mm-hmm. the example of how revelation is made incarnate. I mean,
yeah,
how revelation occurs, and it's only by way of a perfect receptivity,
right?
And like preparation, and therefore perfect receptivity of it,
mm-hmm.
right?
And Gregory talks he talks about this. I have a couple places that I'm thinking of now, but if I can find the one where he says, yeah, 159, paragraph 159, page 93 at the bottom. He talks about the trumpet blast and how it gets louder as you move up the mountain.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then he takes this and turns it into the spiritual interpretation of basically the history of the world,
uh-huh,
and specifically Israel, where he says, the law and the prophets trumpeted the divine mystery of the incarnation. But the first sounds were too weak to strike the disobedient ear, right? So it's specifically, no, it's not just that they were too weak for people to hear. It was too weak for the disobedient ear. So the receptive side wasn't able to receive it. Therefore, the Jews' deaf ears did not receive the sound of the trumpets. As the trumpets came closer, according to the text, they became louder. The last sounds which came through the preaching of the gospels struck their ears, since the Spirit through his instruments sounds a noise more loudly ringing and makes a sound more vibrant in each succeeding spokesman. And the instruments, these instruments are the prophets and the apostles. But it's interesting to think, before they were apostles, they were the deaf Jews, right? I mean, the apostles were all Jews.
Yeah.
So they were the deaf Jews. It was only when it became louder that they were able to hear. I mean, sometimes I think we sort of, you know, we think of the apostles as being just these awesome dudes, right? Mm-hmm. Which is the opposite of what I was saying. Like, we think of them as bumbling idiots sometimes,
yeah,
and they're
yeah.
awesome dudes other
yeah,
times.
Yeah.
But I think here Gregory's kind of pointing out, like, these guys were deaf until he came. And even when he came, they were deaf, right? Going back to this idea that they didn't understand what he was saying until the resurrection happens, right?
Right.
Because there has to be, using Christ's own term, there has to be good soil that is prepared for the reception of the word.
Right? Mm-hmm.
And so two pages before that, on page 92, is where he kind of gets into the fact that not everybody can just enter in and see God, enter into the darkness and see God. This whole paragraph, 153, is really interesting. Let me read some of it. He says, it would be better next, in keeping with the order of the history, to harmonize what is perceived with the spiritual sense. Whoever looks to Moses in the cloud, both of whom are guides to those who progress in virtue. Moses in this place would be the legal precepts in the cloud, which leads the proper understanding of the law, who has been purified by the crossing of the water, who has put the foreigner to death and separated himself from the foreigner, who has tasted the waters of Marah, that is, the life removed far from pleasure. By the way, that I'm now thinking Marah is the same as root as Mary, right? Which means bitterness. Which, although appearing bitter and unpleasant at first to those tasting it, offers a sweet sensation to those accepting the wood, who has then delighted in the beauties of the palm trees and springs, which were those who preached the gospel and who were filled with living water, which is the rock, who received the heavenly bread, who has played the man against the foreigners, and for whom the outstretched hands of the lawgiver became the cause of victory, foreshadowing the mystery of the cross. He it is who then advances to the contemplation of the transcendent nature. But it's only after all this has happened in the history of Israel, and as we've been talking about in this, right, in the history of your own life, right, which is embedded within this history of the people, the one Adam, right? Only when this happens are you able to advance to the contemplation of the transcendent nature. It's the person who has become pure in all things, as he says. On the next page, he talks about the irrational animals being left behind and kept away from the mountain, right? Only when all of this stuff happens can someone actually see God, right? And but then, you know, of course, what does it mean to see God?
Yeah.
And here's where we get really, I think, into the heart of
darkness.
The darkness. The heart of darkness. There we go. Heart of darkness. Joseph Conrad, by the way, was Polish, if you didn't know. I have to point out my polls.
Here's a question. This is right after where you read on paragraph 160, page 94.
Yeah.
And this was something that was somewhat in the back of my mind. I didn't think it was that important, but now I'm starting to wonder how significant this is. So 160, the multitude, is that the
Israelites.
The Pesante? Or no, Pesante.
It starts with an A. Aklas.
Aklas. The multitude. Yeah, that's right, Aklas. Okay. The multitude was not capable of hearing the voice from above, but relied on Moses to learn by himself the secrets and to teach the people whatever doctrine he might learn through instruction from above. This is also true of the arrangement in the church. Not all thrust themselves toward the apprehension of the mysteries, but choosing from among themselves someone who is able to hear things divine, they give ear gratefully to him, considering trustworthy whatever they might hear from someone initiated into the divine mysteries. Mm-hmm. So here you have this fascinating reality of the church, that not all are
apostles, nor are all prophets.
Yeah,
as he says it right in the next
line. Right. And so you have this, not all are going to climb the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't need to climb the mountain to be to flourish, mm-hmm. in a sense, mm-hmm. right? To flourish as a non-prophet or a non-apostle.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is, for me, kind of difficult to wrap my head around in light of what I take this life of Moses to be an allegory of, and in some sense, in light of the baptismal, there's the technical term, in virtue of being baptized, all become priest, prophet, and king,
uh-huh,
whatever
the three munus.
Yeah. How is it that through baptism all aren't all? I don't know. It looks like what he's saying is you have the multitude kind of through their weakness and the recognition of their weakness, permitted, but they're kind of ordained not to be ordained. They're ordained not to be seers.
But they can, in a sense, climb the mountain.
They
on the backs of the seers.
They can, but I think that that's what is it to not, what is it to know God as unknown when the only way to know that is through the reports of others? Which I don't get me wrong, there's nothing, that's not mm-hmm. like a bad thing, but that's not, I don't think that means you're climbing the mountain.
Yeah. I mean,
you're still at the foot of the mountain, but, because Moses comes down. He doesn't, but, say, guy, okay, guy's coming up. Yeah, no, I described it. No. Actually, God described it, but.
Described by not describing it. But, I mean, maybe we need to go to a Gregorian anthropology here, right, of the one Adam. Like, it's not, like, perhaps we're too individualistic in our concern here.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the fact that not everybody climbs the mountain is not because not everybody's awesome, although that's kind of true. But rather it's because the one Adam is awesome.
Yeah.
That's what matters, right?
Yeah.
And maybe the sort of solidarity of man, and he specifically talks about the church here, mm-hmm. which of course mm-hmm. is where the super substance,
yeah.
as I think Ratzinger calls it, it becomes ultimately itself, right? It is the one thing that is in creation. And so I wonder if he doesn't seem to think that choosing someone to hear about divine things from is a pathetic thing to do.
No.
In fact, he in the next paragraph, if you remember, at the very bottom, right? He talks about, you know, those who try to climb it but aren't ready because
yeah.
their garments yeah. are soiled and their irrational animals are surrounding them.
Yeah.
He says they're stoned by their own reasonings.
Yeah.
For heretical opinions are in effect stones which crush the inventor of evil doctrine. That's killer.
Man. That's the exact same point he makes at the very beginning of Contra Eunomian.
Really?
Eunomius doesn't have to cut off his own head.
Yeah.
Like Goliath.
Yeah.
Or no, yeah. He doesn't have to cut off the head of Eunomius because he already did it himself.
Yeah. 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 That is the same thing.
He's cut himself off.
He's cut himself off because
of his own
false reasons. Right. And so Eunomius probably would have been better in just saying, all right, Gregory, go up the mountain. All right, you go into the cloud.
Yeah.
You tell me, you come down and tell me what happened.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he thinks that this is, I think he thinks that it's actually foolish to try to climb the mountain when you're not ready.
Right. So in some ways, the life of Moses, and this is deep. There you go. So the life of Moses cannot be separated from the life of the Israelites. So when you think about the life of Moses, you shouldn't think of it as, oh, this one guy's life.
Yeah.
But really what it is it's a guy's life, which only makes sense in light of the life of the Israelite people.
It's a corporate life.
It's a corporate life. Not in the
post-industrial. Yeah, not the bourgeois understanding of it, right?
Yeah.
Corporate as in one body.
Right.
The body of Christ,
right.
Kind of way.
Right. And so then the way to think of the life of Moses is to think of really the life of the church.
Uh-huh.
But specifically Moses as... I mean, I think he's kind of, all are Moses, all aren't Moses.
Right.
So, I mean, and he's saying, don't get too hung up on this. This is the point he made with like the Aaron.
Yeah. He's made it a couple times at this point.
Yeah. Yeah. And so maybe that's a way to sort of save this, is that what's going on is the life of Moses is the life of the Israelite people. And that's probably what Moses himself would have said.
Yeah. And this is, it seems to me, this is an ancient understanding of just mm-hmm. human personhood.
Right.
That you are not, you know, I've heard people say it was with Saint Augustine that the individual self-consciousness was like born. Right. His Confessions is like the first sign of like reflection on just me as a single thing. And some people lament that, right? And some people celebrate that, right?
Right.
And I think maybe it's a little of both. Because I think the ancient understanding of personality is completely wrapped up in community. And man, this is going right into my seminar class where we've been talking about, you know, how does one have a true community amidst a pluralistic
mm-hmm.
sort of reality of the fact that, you know, on our street, you know, there's you and me.
Yeah.
There's two other families that I can think of that are pretty much on board at the same place,
mm-hmm.
and then there's like three families that I can think of that aren't.
Yeah.
And so how do we have a true community on our block when we have such diversity of foundational first principles and therefore understandings of final ends? But I think when you have an immobile society and you have a very familial ancestral, we live together because we're all related in some way, society, then you don't have that kind of diversity in a bad sense. Because you have unity, right? And unity with true diversity can only happen when there is consubstantiality, not when there's, what's the difference between consubstantiality, anti-substantiality, multi-substantiality? I don't know.
I need to think of
I think that your point here, that the life of Moses is the life of Israel, is the life of the church, is the life of me, is all true.
Right. And so when you think, and so you shouldn't think of Moses going up to the. I mean, here you go. Moses doesn't ascend the mountain for his own sake. Mm-hmm. Right? He does the act of ascending them, and actually he does it with the people initially.
Originally,
they go up,
yeah,
and then they realize
they're like,
"We can't do this.
This ain't
you
for
stay
me.
Up here. You stay up here for us."
Yeah,
and so he stays up for them.
Yeah. So he, in a sense, his going into the cloud is his being for the others,
and was for the sake of his coming back down.
Yes. Right. Yes.
He only went into the cloud to come back.
Right. Right. For the sake of the people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is killer. I mean, that's, I didn't think of any of that stuff when I read it the first time.
I didn't either.
Which is why we learn in community.
I didn't think of that stuff the first time I read it.
Well, let's talk a little bit about his entering into the cloud then. Because.
This is not the iCloud.
No. Definitely not.
Okay.
And in fact, the fact that the iCloud merely holds information that is graspable and let's say fileable.
It's like the opposite of a cloud.
Yeah, we should call it the non-cloud. I'm going to put my files on the non-cloud. but so going back to 150 or paragraph 153, page 92. It's only the person that has been purified and prepared in this way that he can receive true contemplation of the transcendent nature. So if you go to the next page, 93, this is where I realize, is it here? No, it's not here. It's coming up. It's in two pages. But it's here that it begins, where he starts to talk about what does it really mean to see God. And you know, this language of Moses going into the cloud to see God, into the darkness. I mean, this, and I was reading Exodus, finding these words here, right? He goes into the cloud. He goes into the darkness. Gregory's going to get into some of this explanation here of what does that mean for him to do that, right? So paragraph 157, page 93. The contemplation of God is not affected by sight and hearing, nor is it comprehended by any of the customary perceptions of the mind. Okay, so usually we think of not seeing God as, of course, he can't be seen because your bodily eyes only see sensible things, right? But Gregory goes deeper here and he says, not even the customary perceptions of the mind, right? A little bit further in that paragraph, he says something that I was highlighting all over the place. Let me read this sentence, and then the next one is the most important. He who would approach the knowledge of things sublime must first purify his manner of life from all sensual and irrational emotion. He must wash from his understanding every opinion derived from some preconception and withdraw himself from his customary intercourse with his own companion, right? Or this was what was happening in Israel too, right?
Right.
This abstinence from the conjugal act. But that he calls that his sensible perceptions. But going back up, this is really, really interesting where he says he must wash from his understanding every opinion derived from some preconception. This is, this is Heidegger. This is saying if you think you're going to think about God according to some preconception of what being is, or even what creaturely or what non or what creator is not, comparing him to creatures.
Right.
Then you're going to have a preconception, and you're going to walk into the cloud, and you're going to expect to find something, and you're going to look for that thing. And as you're looking for that thing, you're expecting to find. You're not going to see him.
Yeah.
because you're looking for a preconception.
Nor will you see that, what you're looking for.
Well, of course not, because that doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. You definitely won't find that. Mm-hmm. But what you won't find is what's really there, mm-hmm. which is the divine who's beyond every preconception that we have of him.
Maybe this is the source of modern atheism.
That we're looking for
God under...
under preconceptions.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's our fault, right? We're the ones who give the world, we as Christians give the world preconceptions of what we, of what God should be, right? Mm-hmm. That he's this powerful being, a being.
Yeah. And even by entering into argumentation, trying to prove that God exists.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, even Aquinas warns, you got to be really careful when you're arguing for God's existence, because you're going to make God look like a fool.
Yeah. Yeah.
And out of your, you know, sort of piety, you want to do this, but you actually are perhaps doing more harm than
right.
than good.
Right, because lots of times it's you are going to be basing your arguments on preconceptions. You're going to, or they're going to assume you're basing your arguments on preconceptions,
yeah.
and those preconceptions are going to be unsatisfactory,
right.
because that's not what God is. Right. So I think I think this is it's really interesting that he says only the person who purifies himself from sense perceptions and preconceptions. Only that person, when he is so purified, he says at the bottom of that paragraph, then he assaults the mountain. I love how he says assaults the mountain too. The next paragraph he says, you know, the knowledge of God is a mountain steep indeed, difficult to climb, and the majority of people scarcely reach its base. Which, if you think that sounds harsh, I mean, this reminds me of Jesus in Matthew 7:14, where he says that, you know, the way of salvation is narrow and few find it.
Yeah.
Not just few follow it, but few find it. Yeah, right. Yeah. And I've always thought that was really, really hard to hear.
Yeah. Yeah. And so on that paragraph 157 you were reading.
Yeah.
This is an explicit word usage. He must wash from his understanding every opinion derived from some preconception. Opinion is contrasted with knowledge in Plato, and opinions are those things which you need to, through dialectic, you need to purify yourself of, because they're always not the form. Opinion is not what you're seeking. So mm-hmm. you can have opinions of justice, and this is what Socrates is trying to purify all of his interlocutors of through his questioning. He's trying to purify them of their opinions, get rid of their opinions, so that what's left is not a false image of the form.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Interesting. So probably he's got that in the back of his mind when it's.
I mean, I think it's just a very Platonic understanding of epistemology and the way that it kind of plays in this purification of the purification of opinion for the sake of knowledge is like sort of the meat and potatoes of Platonic epistemology.
And it gets right back to the heart of receptivity too, because it's this idea that an opinion is something that I push out into the world
right.
in order to conform it to myself, whereas the reality or the form I can only actually receive.
Yeah.
Right? So I have to purify myself of sort of my power grasp in order that I might receive.
And I think at least for Plato, I think this is also the case for Nyssa. Especially, I think this is especially true of Nyssa, where Plato thinks that you have to become like something in order to know it.
Uh-huh.
So knowledge is always, it occurs by way of making yourself like the object. And this act of purification is an act of getting rid of these opinions so that you're more and more and more similar to the form itself, rather than the opinions,
the preconceptions.
Mm-hmm. And I think what you have is this radical purification, such that when you do that, what's left is this utter purity, which is sort of has the guys, you might say, the form of nothing, but that's because it's so non idolatrous in some ways. It's so open, it's so receptive,
yeah,
that it becomes an image of God.
It's like the rusty mirror, right?
Yeah.
Where you clean off the mirror because you're the divine image.
Yeah.
You clean off the mirror in order that the divine image might shine forth. But what are you then? You are the reflection of Him.
Right? Yeah.
That's what you are.
Yeah. And then if you think that you're a reflection of, if you're a reflection of the Word itself is also in some ways a mirror of, mm-hmm,
of the Father.
Of the Father.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
He who has seen me has seen the Father.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. I haven't thought of it that way, but I think that's true.
Wow.
So let's get into this. I think the most important page in all of our reading today was page 95. What's our time there, Jagger?
50.
Oh, we're okay. We got time.
We got time.
I mean, we've blown all the way to one, hour 10.
Yeah. What are we talking? What's time to a turkey?
What's time to online asynchronous education? Right?
Have you heard that phrase, what's time to turkey?
No.
Probably not, because that was Khaki's like great-grandfather who used to take turkeys to market. And they said, hurry up, the turkeys are waiting. And he said, what's time to a turkey?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
It's very philosophical.
Yeah, yeah. Especially when they're on their way to slaughter, you know.
That's right, right. Well, I think for the rest of this time, I think we can just look at this section in depth from paragraph 162 to 169.
Yeah.
Okay, so he starts off with this very interesting thing, which I feel like we've talked about before in our conversation over these past years. Right? Uh-huh. Let me just start reading here. I mean, this whole section is gold.
We could just quote, read it, and then talk about it. I mean, only a couple paragraphs.
Yeah, well, let's start here with 162. What does it mean that Moses entered the darkness and then saw God in it? What is now recounted seems somehow to be contradictory to the first theophany. What's the first theophany? He's talking about the burning bush, I think, right?
So he refers to it.
For then the divine was beheld in light, but now he is seen in darkness. Let us not consider that this is at variance with the sequence of things we have contemplated spiritually. Scripture teaches by this that religious knowledge comes at first to those who receive it as light. I mean, you just think about the conversion, right? And sort of the freak out post-conversion, right? I always think of my buddy James, who God love him, was let's say not a very good Christian in college, but he was a great friend of mine. Maybe not a true friend, because we had a lot of great fun together.
He was a good buddy.
But he had this major conversion, and he told me he was entering the seminary in like 2 days after he had this major conversion.
Oh, wow.
Now he's not a priest today. He's married and has, as far as I know, 3 kids. I haven't talked to him for a while. I need to get in touch with him. But that was
James. If you're out there,
James, if you're subscribed to the Creative Retrieval Podcast,
if you're out there in the void,
look me up. Give me a call. But anyway, James is a good guy.
Yeah.
So at first, those who receive it as light. Therefore, what is perceived to be contrary to religion is darkness. And the escape from darkness comes about when one participates in light, right? So you escape the darkness of sin by moving into the light of Christ. And it's this glorious seeing. You can now see the world as it really is. Like you know, Emmett at the end of the Lego movie. He goes on. But as the mind progresses, and through ever greater and more perfect diligence comes to apprehend reality, as it approaches more nearly to contemplation, it sees more clearly what of the divine nature is uncontemplated, right? And it's so there's something about you see the world for what it is, but then you recognize, everything's actually more than that. And I can't see that, even though I can see now because of light. There's something about, and I love how he starts the next paragraph, leaving behind everything that is observed, leaving behind everything that observes, not only what sense comprehends, but also what the intelligence thinks it sees. Right? There's the preconceptions. It keeps on penetrating deeper until by the intelligence's yearning for understanding, it gains access to the invisible and the incomprehensible, and there it sees God. Right? So this light that comes about at first and lets you see reality, ultimately, you have to come, if you keep going, you come to the realization, no, this is not really seeing reality. at least I see, in a sense, the darkness, the true darkness of sin, we might say.
Right.
Or maybe it's not the true darkness. Which is the true darkness? I don't know. But
which is darker?
Yeah. It's like that Angelus Silesius, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Man and God are abysses. Which is the deeper? Will you tell me?
Yeah.
But you know, you see the darkness, or you see the light, and then you recognize no, the light isn't really making me see the true God. I have to even put aside what I see and penetrate deeper. And this is where the great line, which I thought came from Pseudo-Dionysius, and now I realize he stole from Nyssa. This is the true knowledge of what is sought. This is the seeing that consists in not seeing, right?
Mm-hmm,
I
mm-hmm.
mean, the first time I saw that was in Pseudo-Dionysius,
yep.
But now I see it here, a seeing that consists in not seeing. Because that which is sought transcends all knowledge, being separated on all sides by incomprehensibility as by a kind of darkness. And this is where the line of the luminous darkness comes in, and no one has ever seen God, right? So this, I think this, there's a progression in knowledge that he's talking about. Just like there's a progression in purity in order to even be able to receive knowledge, right?
Yeah.
Right. The person who becomes purified only after a while can now see the light of the divine presence. But only after further moving and further understanding and further purification does one begin to really apprehend reality and to see God as he really is by not seeing him,
right? Yeah.
Right? By the darkness that surrounds him, which I think is, I mean, I think this is exactly where, this is the story of my own life, right? Where I had a conversion, I moved into light, and then I started really studying theology, and I really thought I was getting it and seeing things. And then after a while, darkness started to invade,
yeah.
And I started recognizing I can't say the things I said before.
Right. And so you either, or my guess is this was, I mean, same story for me. It's the same story for, I imagine, for all honest academics.
Yeah, because as Gregory says, right, it doesn't matter that this was in Egypt or Chaldea.
Yeah,
it's about everyone.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
yeah.
And I think initially what you want to do is you want to say, you want to avoid the darkness and cling to the light that you once had.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so you try to, like, even just ignore.
Yep.
Ignore what Cardinal Ratzinger is saying.
Yeah.
Right. Ignore what Balthasar is saying.
Right.
And
right.
Then I think after a while, the honest intellectual will say, "I can't ignore it any longer.
Yeah.
I have to look at the darkness. I have to move into the unknowing."
That's an asceticism, because what happens is you have to say, everything I've done over the past 10 years, I'm throwing out.
Yeah.
And in one sense, you're not throwing it out, right? Because it was the past 10 years that got you to be able to say,
I can see,
I need to throw it out.
I can see the darkness.
Yeah.
And the darkness isn't ignorance. It's a knowledge beyond knowing in ignorance, right?
Right.
It's sort of move into this new way of understanding, which is, as he says, a non-understanding. It's an understanding. How do you understand the incomprehensible things?
Yeah, it's a knowing ignorance, right? I mean, to use a phrase that maybe Gregory used, I don't remember, but definitely is within his line, right?
Yeah.
Of the watchful sleep, and
it's
a knowing ignorance, right? That's what's really happening here. So let's keep going here.
Yeah,
I mean, this is killer. So when therefore Moses grew in knowledge, he declared that he had seen God in the darkness. That is, that he had then come to know what is divine is beyond all knowledge and comprehension. For the text says, Moses approached the dark cloud where God was. What God? He who made darkness his hiding place, as David says, who also was initiated into the mysteries in the same inner sanctuary. So, you know, I feel like if Gregory wrote a sequel to the life of Moses, it might be the life of David, right? And it would probably say the same stuff, right? It would probably say the same. And we could probably look at the story of David and find a lot of parallels within this sort of understanding of his role in Israel, his being the leader of Israel, the one who goes up the mountain, right?
Yeah.
But in a different sense, right? There would be different accidental circumstances. But it would be saying the same thing, right?
Right.
Which fits right along with the prologue of Gregory's Life of Moses, which says it doesn't matter that we're talking about ancient Israel, right?
Yeah, right.
So I think there's something killer going on here about this. The next paragraph, though, he talks about, this is where God forbids then. In the old law, there's a forbidding of any graven images being made. Right?
Here it is. Moses grew in knowledge, and you get some little.
Where are you looking?
This is on where you just read 95.
Yeah.
164. Moses grew in knowledge. He declared that God had seen in darkness. That is that the divine is beyond all knowledge. So he grew in knowledge that the divine is beyond all knowledge.
Yeah. There it is. Right. So it's a knowing ignorance.
Yeah.
It's a knowing ignorance, but it's not just. It's not just like, I know my ignorance now, but it's there's something positive in the ignorance, right? Yeah. The ignorance itself is positive.
Yeah.
Right? And it's hard to kind of, there's a good endnote where he talks about this too.
It's interesting that it's also, later people will talk about this as an experiential knowledge. So clearly everyone knows. I mean, this is at a much lower level, but everyone knows that the knowledge of riding a bike is very different from what you have on a piece of paper or what you could put on a piece of paper.
Right.
So the knowledge of bike riding is not a descriptive type of knowledge.
Right.
And I think something at a much deeper level, knowledge of being itself is not a descriptive type of knowledge.
Yeah.
Because it's an active experience that is what constitutes the knowledge. It's not doxastic
in
the sense.
So in a sense, then it's incommunicable.
Yeah.
Right. So Moses can't come down and say, "Here's what I saw," but I wonder if it's incommunicable because God is incommunicable, right? So if my knowledge or my contemplation of God is unable to, I'm unable to tell that to somebody else. It's because God's unable to tell himself to somebody else.
Yeah.
But paradoxically does.
Yeah.
And this is where we go beyond being, right?
Yeah.
Because he does in the word which himself is the full speaking of the Father.
So it's almost as if you could say he's not communicable because there's nothing prior to him by which he could be communicated.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of this, to make sense of something, to explain something, you have to appeal to something more fundamental. Rather, what God is pure communication. He's perfect communication, which is why you can't look to anything else to explain or to communicate, make sense of, however you want to think of it, God.
So perfect communication then is incommunicable communication.
Right. Yeah.
I totally understand that.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever that means.
Yeah. We could keep going on, but
yeah, but. No. So he kind of gets a little bit into virtue here, which I think is very interesting.
Oh, you at the top of here.
Yeah.
I don't know if you were gonna. I cut you off from talking about the idolatry.
So the divine word at the beginning forbids that the divine be likened to any of the things known by men, since every concept which comes from some comprehensible image by an approximate understanding and by guessing at the divine nature constitutes an idol of God and does not proclaim God, right? And I think in a sense this is what you're saying, right? You can't communicate God by comprehensible images.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing is that he calls them idols. Now, but remember what Gregory said, we have to purify ourselves up, right? Not only are we purified, but what we see and hear, but by any of the customary perceptions of the mind, by every opinion derived from some preconception. So even those are idols, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I feel like this is what I've been trying to teach in my classes for the past year and a half, is that when you come to God with a preconception of what God is, you are not talking about God.
Yeah, I wrote in the margin, conceptual idolatry.
Yeah, and I think this is what... we were talking about this in De Lubach, but I thought it was in his connection with understanding Nietzsche. And maybe, I don't know if you know, does Nietzsche kind of talk about this sort of thing as well? Not to put you on the hot seat here.
I mean, in regards to...
To sort of theists' explanations or understandings of gods as being not, as being idols. I mean, maybe that's Heidegger, right?
Yeah. I think in some ways it's Heidegger. I mean, the way that Nietzsche thinks that's in some ways what God that's the way Christians have conceived of God.
And I think he's right.
Yeah.
Overall.
And right. And therefore, and we've given up on that idol, and therefore God's dead. That idol, the thing that we thought we understood, that made sense of our lives, we no longer appeal to, because now we appeal to something, we appeal to a new idol, science.
Right.
Which, I mean, he does think it's science is still a type of God, because they still worship truth itself. But it's soon, at some point in the future, he thinks they'll give up on truth itself, and so the scientists will die in the sense of objective science. And,
yep.
And so, I do think he's trying to, I mean, one of his last books, The Twilight of the Idols.
Idols, yeah, right? Yeah.
So I think he thinks that that's just what religion is
right.
It's idol worship.
Well, I wonder if Gregory is,
because there's nothing else.
Yeah, Gregory is. Besides that last point, I wonder if Gregory's agreeing with him, right? That so many people worship idols, which I wonder if we can attach this understanding of the virtuous philosopher, in the Gregorian sense, who purifies himself of sight, hearing, and preconceptions, is the one who really lives the Christian mode of life. That others who have preconceptions, that others who think they know God in a particular way, are undeserving of the word Christian. They're the monkey. They're the monkey going after the sweetmeats. Yeah. Right? And maybe in another sense, like our world today is a demasking of that. And although we look out at the vast number of atheists in the modern West, and we think we're in dire straits, I wonder if it's just more honest to say everything else was sweetmeats before.
I mean,
and we're all monkeys.
Because Eunomius wore the mask of Christianity.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Arius wore the mask of Christianity.
Right.
And I think what you have now is the modern day...
Joel Osteen. I mean, kind of, right?
Yeah. But I was gonna say
there are extreme examples.
Yeah, I was gonna say there
so
aren't. There aren't as many mask wearers because they're not trying to be Christian, right?
Right.
Because they've given up on that idol.
Yeah, because in a sense, the culture it's no longer advantageous to be Christian.
Yeah.
I mean, even back when we were kids, well, maybe when I was a kid, you're forgetting how young you are. When
it was in the 80s.
Yeah, but even back when both of us were kids, right? I mean, the American, just as an example, I'm not saying that this is the end all be all, the American politicians would appeal to their own Christianity and to their own belief in God.
Yeah.
And in my own lifetime, I've seen that waning more and more and more and more.
Yeah.
You know, to where, what was the great line of John Kerry when they asked him what his favorite?
Oh yeah.
I forget what this was. Right. What's your favorite passage from the Gospels? And he started talking about Job or something.
Yeah.
Or Jonah.
Yeah.
I mean, that was like when Christianity and politics started to jump the shark.
Yeah.
Now it's just basically unreferenced.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And it's not seen as being necessary to be referenced. And I'm not saying we should lament this. In some sense, we should. In another sense, let's call a monkey a monkey.
Yeah.
Right. And not call him a Christian.
Right.
And most people are okay with that now. Mm-hmm. And so instead of having fake Christians now, you just have non-Christians.
Yeah.
Right. Which is in a sense more honest. And hopefully, and this is maybe where Ratzinger is going when he talks about the church being smaller but more vigorous reality. Mm-hmm. Maybe what he means is that those who claim Christianity are the ones who are actually undertaking the mode of Christian life.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway,
yeah.
We're probably out of time here. Unless you had any last points we didn't get to, because I've been kind of running the show here.
No, dear. No, it's your show to run, though.
Yeah, it is my show to run, but... But nonetheless, you know, there's the really important war with Amalek, right?
Yeah.
If you want to learn more about that, read Thérèse of Lisieux's letter to Father Rouland about about her being Moses on the mountain and him being Joshua on the ground fighting the animals. It's beautiful.
Nice. Yeah.
It's beautifully done. But he has other understandings here too, right? And of course, the manna is really important as well, especially sort of this idea of preparing for the Sabbath. There's a lot more here, but we're probably out of
That's
time.
That's probably good.
But the key was the darkness, right? I mean, this is one of the main reasons why this class is happening. Is I want to really dive into this stuff. Hopefully, you guys do too. And at this point, and seeing the importance of diving into
the
darkness.
This is Jaeger's final thoughts. that if this is if what Nyssa says about God being known in this type of way, and therefore not being known in other types of ways, more standard types of ways, that's going to require a new epistemology for God, in a sense, a new epistemology for maybe a lot of us. And so you shouldn't think about, okay, I want my brother or my sister or my friend or my boyfriend or my cousin to come to believe in God. So what I need to do is I need to, read a bunch of books on how to make your brother, girlfriend, uncle, what have you, believe in God. Because
it's like when we were talking about how to go on a date.
Yeah. Because I think
that was this podcast with the other one. I don't remember.
Yeah. But I think if you're doing that, you're presupposing, you're basically saying, okay, how can I get someone to believe an idol?
Yeah.
And that's a great danger.
Right.
This is why I think you have to be really, really, really careful about how to prove, quote unquote, prove God to someone.
Right.
Because you might actually do more harm than good. I think the best way is to show the existence of God in your life.
Manifested in your being.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because if you read the book, How to Make My Friend Believe in God, you didn't notice the subtitle, Eunomianism 101.
Yeah, that's right. That's true.
On that note,
we need to make sure we stick with that old-time religion.
It was good for our fathers. It was good for our fathers. It was good for our fathers, and it's good enough for me. And it will save all our children. It will save all our children. It will save all our children. And it's good enough for me. And it was good for Paul and Silas. It was good for Paul and Silas. It was good for Paul and Silas. And it's good enough for me. And it will do what I